The Sweet Sound of Success show is brought to you by The Mentor Studio. The Mentor Studio is an exclusive mentoring and training program for social influencers, business owners, entrepreneurs, coaches, and startups, bringing personal development to the underserved around the world. And brought to you by Success Strategists, simple strategies that work to develop your business with flow and ease using proven strategies and the right tactics. This is the Sweet Sound of Success with Sue Wilhite, Profit Attraction Master.
Terri Di Mauro, aka the RelationChick, is a published author, speaker, and relationship coach who focuses on guiding people through the process of developing healthy connections with themselves and others. A longtime mental health advocate and always the go-to for advice, she has launched her coaching services to share her insights with as many people as possible. Her ultimate goal is to show people how to love themselves and start living the positive lives they deserve. Welcome, Terri.
Thank you, Sue. I'm so happy to be on with you today.
Oh, I'm thrilled that you're on today. This is going to be so cool.
Yeah.
So for my viewers who may not be familiar with the show, the way that the show goes is that it follows the subtitle, which is The Hero's Journey for the Entrepreneur's Soul. And as such, we're taking 5 segments out of The Hero's Journey that was first proposed by Joseph Campbell. And we're going to do the ordinary beginning, the call to action, the big hairy monsters that we all get to play with. And then there is the allies, mentors, guides, coaches, the folks who help us entrepreneurs, right? We couldn't live without, and yet the media shows entrepreneurs slaving away alone. Don't do that. And so I'm here, I've included that part of that segment in this because people need to know that we cannot do it alone. We do need coaches, guides, and mentors. And finally, the return home. And if you remember The Lord of the Rings, when Frodo finally makes it home, he's completely lost. He's changed the world. He's saved the world from deep disaster and doom. And he's come up against all kinds of things that folks in the village just never encountered. And so as an entrepreneur, we may not be, you know, climbing up Mount Doom and throwing rings into fires, in fact, of volcanoes, right? Sometimes feels that way, but we really haven't. But we have changed. We're different. And folks at home may or may not understand what's going on. So that's always a fascinating part of the journey is how do you deal with the folks who, why do you want to be an entrepreneur? When are you going to get a real job? All of that. So, Terri.
Yes.
What was your ordinary beginning?
I mean, my ordinary beginning was, I think, doing what a lot of people do and, you know, following the path out of high school into post-secondary. But it was different for me because each time I completed a program, and I completed a few of them, at least 3, it never felt right. Mm-hmm. And I was missing something out of it. So I always did really well in school. And I had that love-hate relationship, right? Where it's like, when you're in it, you're like, oh, I hate this. But as soon as I was out, I missed it. And I think part of that is because I am a lifelong learner. And I also think that's one of the top qualities of an entrepreneur is always wanting to learn more and further yourself. So my most recent one was to go into teaching. I became a certified teacher here in Ontario. Wow. And I ended up in unfortunately never getting a classroom position, because anybody who's here will tell you it's really difficult to get onto the list. But I was able to do a lot of work in daycares just because I worked really well with younger kids. And so that's where I say my humble beginnings really were, and where I really started to feel like I needed to be in an environment where what I said mattered, and where I didn't have to prove my intelligence or my opinion to anyone, because I had a lot of headbutting issues with me being in the classroom and a supervisor not, and them not understanding the flow, and like, it got really messy.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Headbutting is probably another one of those aspects of early entrepreneurs that people should recognize. It's like, no, stop doing this. Just go.
Yeah. And it was something I encountered a lot. Like I was very good at understanding, you know, you respect your superiors, your elders, especially when you're like fresh out of school. But as I got older and my superiors and I started kind of evening out age-wise, I started getting frustrated because I wasn't that novice kid anymore, and they were still treating me that way.
Right. Exactly. So that sounds like they were some of the, without being judgmental about them, they were some of the big hairy monsters.
I mean, it's true. And like you said, there's no judgment. We got along fine. I found out how to communicate with them properly. And you know, I worked at a certain location for a number of years and was quite happy with it. But it really was that catalyst of, you know what, I need to work for me, because I am aware of my intelligence. I know what my worth is as an employee. I just need to figure out how to do it for myself.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Exactly. So what was the final call to action? What was the thing that burst you out of the cocoon, so to speak?
It had to be, and with the same undertones, it had to be trying to re-enter the workforce after having my son. Mm-hmm. And going on countless interviews for jobs that I knew I could do if they gave me the chance, and constantly trying to prove to them that they should, and then never getting it.
Right.
And I went on, I used to do really well, but I was doing interviews for stuff like retail. And so like easier things where you can kind of get in, but these were more higher level jobs. And I just couldn't convince them that I could do the work, even though I knew I could. And I kind of sat there and I was like, I'm done trying to convince people. Like if I have to convince anybody, I'm going to go out and convince people who don't think I can do it on my own.
Right. So yeah, it's okay. Taking the reins. Here we go.
Yep. And it was, sorry, go ahead. Yeah.
No, I was just saying, journey begun. Let's go.
Exactly. And I still wanted, having worked with children for such a long time, I wanted to be able to stay home with my son for as long as possible. Especially since, I mean, we live in Toronto, daycare costs are like basically another rent. Right. So, you know, if I could find a way to make money, but stay home with him, and you may hear him in the background, that was going to be what I was going to do.
Right. Perfect. So were there any other big hairy monsters that you had to dance with?
I mean, I would call my experience with my chronic illnesses those big hairy monsters, mm-hmm. because they took me out and they put me down a lot. There was a good 2-year period where like I was basically couch or bed bound. And I knew I still wanted to put my gifts out there for people. But these illnesses really put me down for a while. And I started getting a lot of self-doubt and doubting my self-worth. And having to overcome that was huge in being able to actually step into entrepreneurship.
Right. Yes. Chronic illness is one of the more common calls to action, and big hairy monsters, like I said, they tend to be conflated.
Yeah.
that entrepreneurs talk about, that they, it seems to be an obstacle. Mm-hmm. But if you let it be an obstacle, if you let it be your story, oh, I have a chronic illness, I can't do anything, then yeah, that becomes your life. But if you become, okay, so this thing is happening and that's where I'm going. That's what I'm doing. And we're going to kind of deal with that along the way. Mm-hmm. That's an entrepreneur. That's what you do. And yeah. Other problems that show up in entrepreneurship become kind of, hey, yeah, but I got this chronic illness. Don't bother me with these other problems. Already dealt with that. Go.
Had enough of that one already.
you think this is a problem. No.
It's true, though. It really does allow you to kind of like step back and take in a whole picture. So, and I've been able to adapt that to my entrepreneur life as well. So, you know, when I wasn't well, it was like, okay, I'm not well, so I can't do anything. Or, you know what, I'm not feeling well, so I'm not going to eat well, so I'm not going to try and move my body. And Then you take that step back and you realize, well, you know what, those few things are still in my control. And yeah, so you got to bring back up from that spiral and start really focusing on the things that are within your control that you can focus on when you can focus on them. And, you know, I still have days where, you know, I might have to cancel an appointment and say, you know what, I really can't do it today. And I know that if I take that day, then I'll be able to get back to it tomorrow. Whereas if I try and push through, I might be taken out for a couple of weeks. So right. Learning that balance was really important for both the chronic illness and now, you know, taking on projects and saying, you know, yes to different aspects of being an entrepreneur, you're finding that balance again.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So who were some of your guides, mentors, Gandalfs?
Some of my amazing wizards, right? I have been so fortunate to really have a lot of encouragement through my journey. And I've, you know, kind of changed focus a few times again to find the right path for me. And every time I had the best support. So my husband's been absolutely incredible. You know, he's always wanting to make sure that I'm doing the best I can to get myself out there, not just to make the money, but to, you know, be happy in what I'm doing. He's all about tech. So he knows a lot of stuff that I don't know on the tech side. He's helped me out so much with that sort of stuff. He got like my entire setup here is all from him. So that was great. His parents are amazing. My mom. And then when you get into, you know, people who are already in the industry. I was very fortunate to attend Pride Week with Ken Krell, which was huge. I think that's where you and I met, actually, Sue. Yeah. And yeah, from there we got into the mentor studio, and it's just been our like, sponsor. That's right. And it's been incredible. I know, and I completely appreciate that a lot of people had trouble with the pandemic and everything moving online. For someone like me, it let me thrive and really grow and meet people I never would have met otherwise.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. I think that's been one of the boons to entrepreneurs is the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And yeah, there's a bunch of businesses that closed. And to a certain extent, I have a little bit of judgment, I admit, that goodness gracious, just pivot.
That was the word of the year, wasn't it?
The word of the year. Oh my God, there were so many networking opportunities. There were so many things, so many opportunities that became available this last year.
Yeah.
That things are still, you know, exploding and opening up, and new directions are, you know, I'm getting whiplash. Ooh, that, you know, anybody with shiny object syndrome
is exactly
having a difficult time because, oh, that opportunity and that opportunity and that's come up and this has come up and how many networking groups can you single week?
It's true. The first half of the year, of this year, that was completely me. I told my husband, I said, look, I'm going to do something I've never done before, and I'm just going to say yes to everything. And I'm gonna see what happens. And I did it and it was exhausting. And I'm stopping that now. I'm being more selective, but I gave myself that little bit of time to just be like, you got an opportunity, let's do it. You know what? That scares the heck out of me. Let's do it. And it helped me grow immensely.
Right. Obviously, your journey home then has been pretty successful. If it sounds like your family is like right there behind you, that is so awesome. That is that to have that kind of support is just absolutely grand. Has there been anybody that you've had to convince that being an entrepreneur is an okay thing?
Me. I've had to convince myself the most, I think. And you know what? I know one of the biggest things about being an entrepreneur is the financial insecurity that comes with it. So it's something that comes up between me and my husband frequently, as it should, because we're adults, that's what we do. But that would be the only, you know, area where sometimes you get a little bit of pushback, but it's not even like you should stop what you're doing. It's more, well, how can we do it better? Right. So it's still supportive. I would say like my biggest naysayer has been me, and I'm really letting go of that.
Right. That is the one of the other things that has taken off during the pandemic is the whole self-worth movement and recognizing one's own value and that you can be who you really are. Like, no kidding. And if being an entrepreneur is it, then, you know, go for it full bore. Because as one of my early coaches said, your people are waiting for you.
I love it so much. And I think one thing that kind of took me aback a little bit when I first started, it was because I was getting into coaching. So I started following like all of these other coaches. And then you worry that like the market is saturated with all these coaches, you know, why would they choose me? And actually, I remember Michael Silvers asked me that. He's like, well, you know, why you over anybody else? And I said, well, not because I'm better than anyone, but my experiences are different. Yeah. And there's enough coaches for everybody out there because we all do something different.
Yes. As I point out to my clients who are fussing about saturation in whatever market they're in, 7.5 billion people on the planet. Even if you chop that in half and say half of them are not eligible for whatever reason, that's still 3.25 billion people.
That's a big number.
That's a big number. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Once you open that up, it's like, oh, right. Okay. Yeah.
Sorry, I just got handed smoothie and water, so I think he's trying to tell me something. But absolutely, and that was again a big block that I had to overcome myself, was just knowing again my worth as who I am, and my worth lies in my experiences. And there'll be people I connect with and I coach, and there'll be people that I meet and the connection won't be there, and that's fine too.
Yes, exactly. You have to know who you're not going to work with. Very important.
Yes.
So, Terri.
Yes.
I understand that you have something special to offer our viewers and listeners. And what would that be?
I've put together a nice little guide, and it's called Jumpstarting a Better Relationship with Yourself. And you can find that very simply by going to my website at therelationchick.com, and it'll be on the front page, and you can download a copy all for yourself, and you can go through that and check it out. There's a few different organizer templates. There's some quizzes on your values. And I even included the very first chapter of my book, 7 Days to a More Positive You.
Nice.
Good. Yeah.
So, Terri, one more bonus question.
Oh, good.
If there was anything that you could do 7 days a week, 365 days a year, that's an aspect of your business, you know, whether it's a particular kind or type of client issue, or type of client or some aspect of what it is that you do, what would that, what that just lights you up? You're just like, oh yes, give me more of that. What would that be?
It would have to include travel. It would have to include, you know, doing those big stage talks and feeling that energy from the audience and knowing that they're coming along with me and that I can bring them to this amazing realization that, hey, you're worth it.
Right.
That's all I want people to know.
Cool.
Yeah.
Awesome answer. Well, thank you, Terri. I am so happy to have met you in the various places with Ken Krull's Pride Produce Ridiculously Interactive.
Irresistible?
Irresistible.
Digital yes. events.
Yes.
That's the one.
Sorry, Ken.
You'd be sitting there and be going, come on, Sue.
And of course, the Mentor Studio, which is one of our sponsors. And it's been delightful interviewing you. You've got great energy.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for being on my show.
Oh, thank you for having me, Sue. This was a lot of fun. And again, I mentioned it to you before we started, but I love how unique your format is. It was fun for me to go through that journey with you again.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you to all of my viewers and listeners on The Sweet Sound of Success.
Your dreams for your business. You know what drives me crazy? Really smart business owners denying their talents because they've been taught it has to be hard, because they've been taught that they don't deserve their gifts, that they're not worth anything. They've been taught that their gender means they can't express their genius. I'm Sue Wilhite, and I want you to have access to your genius. I want you to go out and rock the world with your genius. So I created the Call to Action Coaching Program. It's all about getting to the heart of you and what you've got to share with the world to make a profitable business that thrives. It allows you to make a difference in the world. Click the link to sign up for the Call to Action Coaching Program today. Don't let your genius go unnoticed.